Everybody, welcome to the show. I am Ted Stryker, joined by a fantastic singer and songwriter, Billy Raful. What's up, Billy?
How you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you?
Good. Very happy to be here.
Canada, you're representing the patch right there. That is where you are from, right?
Yes, it is. Right across from Detroit. I was born in Windsor,
okay.
Ontario.
So at 19, you go to Nashville, and I want to get all into that, but I want to rewind a little bit mm-hmm. to your growing up years. What was your family like? Was it a musical family?
Absolutely.
Tell me about it.
Absolutely. Musical, artistic, very creative between my mother and my father, both very creative minds. My dad's a singer, songwriter, rock and roll musician for way before before I came along, and my mom, a painter, a writer, you know, teacher, but the core of them both very much music lovers and different kinds of music, yet somehow the same. So me and my brother, Peter, grew up in a very, very creative household.
Now, what was it about your house, your family, that really inspired you to be like, this is what I'd like to do?
I think, you know, it's because it wasn't forced upon us, probably, just because we had it at our disposal all the time, right? And we had instruments around the house, and constantly listening to music and hearing my dad sing or seeing my mom paint. And it wasn't forced on us. We always had it there, and our love for it was very strong. And for me, it was, when I was younger, I was into hockey and playing sports poorly.
You have the height though, man. You have the height.
I didn't get the height until after I stopped playing. I was a goalie, and
the skinniest goalie in Canada.
No, I was chubbier and I was shorter. And then literally as soon as I stopped playing, I got taller and thinned out, could probably cover more than that. And so I missed it.
You were playing sports, you were being very creative, and I want to talk about your dad a minute, who you've talked about, a songwriter, a rocker. He was playing to real a good amount of people out there, right?
Oh yeah, and still is, and still is. Mm. And he's shared the stage with so many legends and
like who? People. Who are some of the folks he's?
For John Entwistle, he's open for Joe Cocker.
Wow.
You know, he's been on stages where giant stadium, you know, the Palace of Auburn Hills in Detroit. These, you know, bigger venues, and he's got to get his music to so many ears all over the place, and getting to see that growing up is just kind of crazy for us.
You were playing sports. You talked about getting the hockey sticks. When did you get your own guitar?
I was 10 years old. It was a Fernandez. It had a Union Jack on it and a built-in amplifier in the guitar. So it's just kind of funny.
Wow.
So you could like little speaker in there.
Right.
And with like 100 different sounds, and you could take it everywhere. It was like a one man. She didn't need an amp. Didn't need cables. Didn't need a battery. And I was 10. I got it for my birthday, I'm pretty sure.
Who are some of the artists that you did discover on your own, whether you're 12 or 16
years
old?
Yeah, so as soon as I could, you know, play the, you know, enough anyways. But I wanted to learn like all the White Stripes riffs. And got into that rib pretty heavy. And every time my dad come around, he'd say like, oh, you get a new one. And I would be learning like, you know, obviously Seven Nation Army right away. And
right.
Then, like Icky Thump and stuff like that. I remember sitting in front of the computer trying to figure out what was going on.
And Jack White, the connection, he's from Detroit.
From exactly, so close. And I think that was a big, like, wow, you know, we're so close. And Motown's so close and so much history and so many great, great musicians.
You got out, you feel you should. And I keep trying to tell myself I would have done the same had I could. But I never thought that you would. Till you came the eye of a storm, you took off from that outbound platform. And you went east, cause it's easy, don't mind if you leave, as long as you come back home. Girl, I went south to define, someday you'll find no different than I was before. Until then, I'm still looking for you in every dark four door. Until then, I'm still looking for you in every dark four door. And I don't sleep enough at night, imagining your silhouette. I draw the outline of you in my mind. Since you went east, cause it's easy, don't mind if you leave, long as you're coming back home. So I went south to define, someday you'll find me no different than I was before. Until then, I'm still looking for you in every dark four door. Until then, I'm still looking for you in every dark four door.
What was it that took you from, I like playing White Stripes songs, Jack White is a wizard, yes, but I want to do this and maybe write some songs on my own?
I was writing the songs before I could properly play the guitar, and definitely before I could, you know, start thinking about singing. I had like a little rig of gear that came somewhere after my 10th birthday, but, you know, 14, around there, from a family friend, and I was writing the songs, but I didn't have any ambition to start playing them live until I started playing coffee houses and you know, open mic nights and stuff like that. I'd seen my father perform locally, and one concert that always sticks out in my mind was him playing at what would be my future high school, playing at the football field. you know, for a bunch of family, friends, and fans.
Right.
And there was a lot of people, and there was everyone singing along, singing his songs, and that was one of the, I don't want to say turning point, but one of the experiences that made me think, oh, I want to do this for real.
Did you have to say to your dad and mom and dad, this is what I want to do, or was it fairly easy to
Yeah,
say?
I always make the joke that they did the hard work, and my father had the hard conversation about wanting to be, you know, a musician, which is a different career.
And tough. Than normal.
Yeah, oh yeah.
And
absolutely.
Tough.
Absolutely.
Did he try to dissuade you at all? Not
no.
not in a bad way, but like, look, son, this is hard to get from one level to the next, what you are going to try to do.
Definitely didn't try and sway me away from it, but, you know, he knew that I knew what I wanted to do, and he knew that from watching him put in the hours, days, and years, you know, into it, he knew that I knew what I had to do if I wanted to do it for real, and what the hardest parts were, I think. And it was, yeah, I don't think there was even a conversation about it. It was just, get to work.
So was that the main advice, or did he give you some other advice as well?
Yeah, I always like to say that he you know, very much when it comes to music being, you know, your career, led by example, and is still doing that, you know, and it's nonstop every day. Real working class, you know,
right.
Musician. And not to take it for granted, because, you know, every night you get to go and perform for people, and that's it's your deepest love, and at the same time you get paid to do it, and that puts food on the table, and you can't ask for much more than that.
Lost in love, you wanna get lost in me. You never can get enough, whatever you think you need. No matter how hard I try, I never can beat this rush. And nobody get me high, the way I do when we touch. Difficult. do. On and off, difficult to allow to let you go. Yeah. And now, who's gonna hold me like you do? And who's gonna hold you like I do?
Avicii, who some people say, oh, it's DJ, this guy, from my vantage point, is just an incredible in-studio producer.
Yep.
And you worked with him.
Absolutely.
UB Love?
Yes.
Yes. Who reached out to who, and what was that experience like?
That was another surreal experience. In Nashville, I had, previous to that, written a song called I See You, that ultimately came out with another producer named Kygo. And we had done that probably a year prior to me working with Avicii. And my management and my label were kind of like, oh, this is totally different, you know, having an EDM producer on it, you know, on a track that I'd written, or, you know, produce a track that I'd written.
Right.
And that's how that went down. Well, Avicii's working on his next project. He's coming to Nashville. Do you want to get in the room? I was like, absolutely. Why not? Of course. Like, and that spawned UB Love, getting in the room with him in Nashville in the studio with Tillery Lindsay and Nathan Chapman and Avicii and I. It was truly both experiences, both working with Avicii and Kygo, were surreal. And they're both immensely talented.
Then I would gladly take my next step. Be the rain coming down, or the flood. Come on, take me till I drown. I need you now. You be love, I will be your love, I will be your love. Love you like no other. Woke up to bleeding cards from people I don't know no more. Woke up to blue above and blue below these wooden floors. This kind of thing you can't be told, the kind of thing you won't be told. I drove home on the interstate, wishing I had learned to fly. She's my Canadian girl on the fifth day of July. This kind of thing you can't be told, this kind of thing you won't be told. And she said time and time again, I wouldn't be alive if it wasn't for the summer of 1975. It'll never be, it'll never be the same. And everyone gets a moment when it'll never be the same again. Someday I'll write it down. I don't know the story ends, but I know that it began this way. This kind of thing you can't be told, this kind of thing you won't be told. When she said time and time again, I wouldn't be alive if it wasn't for the summer of 1975. It'll never be, it'll never be the same. Everyone gets a moment when it'll never be the same again. This kind of love you can't be told, this kind of love you won't be told. It'll never be the same. It'll never be the same again. It'll never be. It'll never be the same. And everyone gets a moment when it'll never be the same again. She said time and time again that I wouldn't be alive if it wasn't for that summer of 1975.
You mentioned playing coffee houses, playing to probably, I assume, very small crowds in the beginning in Canada.
Absolutely.
How did you get those gigs?
Locally, you know, word of mouth and friends and family, and obviously having my father helped a whole bunch. And I remember getting into talent shows in high school and playing Beatles songs in talent shows.
And then going from one level to the next. So you're playing in front of anybody you can. Mm-hmm. What takes you to like the most consistent gigs before you went to Nashville?
Getting out to Windsor, so I'm from, you know, Leamington, which like I said is 45 minutes from Windsor. And I was playing in the county and started to play in little neighboring towns, and then getting to Windsor and getting like a more steady weekly, and then some places weekly, some places biweekly, and getting into okay, I'm here every Wednesday night, I'm here every other Thursday, or I'm here on the weekends, I'm here, you know. And that helped because some nights, oh, it was a great Saturday night and the bar was jam-packed, and other nights it was three people on a Wednesday.
Oh.
Or you're playing in between the intermissions on a playoff hockey game that's going on for like three overtimes.
Right.
I'm just doing 20-minute sets in between each period.
What were some of the early lessons you learned on your own playing all these gigs?
It's crazy. It's like when you start, you gotta play a whole bunch for a small amount of people all night and as much as you can every night. And then as you try and climb the ladder, you're getting in front of bigger crowds at the bottom of bills for less time. And you gotta play for like 30 minutes. Whereas,
right,
you know, and then back at the bar, you play for 4 hours. You play like, you know, from nine to one or something,
yeah,
right? And with little breaks in between. And that's where you start and you keep doing this. Something that I've watched my dad do for years and still does it. And it teaches you how to, sustain it. And then also reminds you that that's where you want to get to. You want to be able to, it's funny, you start playing all that music every night in bars, whether they're cover songs or originals, and then you ultimately want to get to a place where you can play 2.5 hours, 3 hours, that's the dream, is to getting in front of large audiences and playing that much music of your own music for that long. The greats, seeing Paul McCartney or Bruce Springsteen go and put on these long, crazy shows just full of songs that everyone knows every single song.
Yes, and even a generation younger, you can see it happening with the Foo Fighters.
Yeah, exactly. That was going to be the next guy I mentioned there, and the Foo Fighters and Dave Grohl. Absolutely. You go to these shows and it's like there's people playing, 3 hours of their own music.
Right. Let's talk about actual songwriting. Mm-hmm. We've had so many guests on this show, and I've heard a lot of different ways that people do it, and it's something I'm very interested in, especially with the young artists as yourself, who I know writes and writes and writes. But what is the process to go from a total blank idea in space to actually getting it done?
I think, for me anyway, it's like I try not to kill ideas too soon, and mm-hmm. whether it's a guitar part or a lyric or a melody, a word even, or a concept, just kind of banking things because you never know when they're going to fit together with other things.
When you're banking your ideas, are you writing them down? Are you singing your phone? Are you giving yourself notes?
Phone is so helpful, for clips.
Is it melodies or words?
It's definitely more often words inside of melodies than just melodies on their own. I would definitely say so, yeah. Most of the time it's lyrically based.
There's a new-ish song that you released called Acoustic.
Yeah.
With?
Well, it was a collaboration actually with Julia Michaels and Justin Tranter, the both of them. And it's a song that's been around for me anyway in my life for a while now, years. the first song the three of us wrote together. We've written a bunch since then. And yeah, it's very happy to have it out in the world.
Right.
And how did that one come together?
It transformed that song over time, I think. We got it done, and it was very quick, and in like a couple hours. We had it recorded in Los Angeles. I was writing so much at the time and constantly writing. I think maybe 6 to 9 months later, I said, oh, that song, shared it around, and everyone was like, this is, you know, really special. We need to put this, make this a priority. And then it sat in that, another priority box for like, you know, more months, and months went on. And I was in the studio with Mike Crossi, who is the producer I work with most. And he's, you know, I can't speak enough about Mike, but truly, truly an incredible talent. And he heard it a completely different way that we had written it. And that one, it took, we did a couple different versions, and the one that we ended up landing on was so far different than the original demo, yet lyrically and melodically very much the same, but what was going on underneath it. And it's, you know, something I'm very happy to have out, and, you know, very proud that it finally saw the light of day.
Now, how do you meet Ms. Michaels? She just Grammy nominated this past year.
It's
kudos to her.
I know. She's another person I can't speak highly enough about. You know, she's, as you know, and everyone knows, immense talent.
Like, yes.
It's crazy. Blows me away. Like, every time we get in the same room together, it's really ridiculous. But also just a great person all around, and so super sweet. And I got in a room with her for the first time. It's like 3 years ago, and my now publisher, and I don't think when we were introduced, I was working with her, but Katie said, you need to meet this girl. She's in, you know, she's gonna be huge. You just got to get in a room with her. She's so super talented. And I think we met the next day, and we had written another song that we're playing here today called "I'm Not a Saint."
Yes.
That was. Julia and I had written that within 45 minutes of meeting each other, and it was done, and one of my favorites on this first album, for sure.
Well, I've had one too many cigarettes burning up my lungs, the taste of one too many lips hanging off my tongue. Oh. Oh. Sunday morning, getting high, drinking here alone. Get up a brand new alibi for not coming home. Oh, oh no. And I'm sorry I lied so much. I'm not a saint, but I could be if I tried. Lord knows I've got habits to break. I'm really good at being good at goodbye. I'm gonna give you fair warning that I'm not a saint, but I could be if I tried. Cause Lord knows I don't learn from mistakes. I'm not here unless I'm here by your side. I'm not a saint, but I could be if I sober up and settle down. Give a little talk about how I can't keep from running round. Say it's not your fault. Oh. Lord knows I've got habits to break. I'm really good at being try. As Lord knows, it's all of a mistake. And I don't hear unless I'm here by your side.
What came first, Billy? Going to Nashville or singing demos for other artists?
So that specific story where I was singing demos happened once, and it was, I guess, in many ways, the right place and time, and a family friend of my father's, who was a songwriter and a producer. My dad was actually singing the demos that day, and they had me in singing on a verse, and he liked my voice and said, "Hey, man, like, play me something."
Wait, who liked it?
The songwriters.
Okay.
Yeah, his name is Marlon Young. And he pulls me out of the booth and says, "Hey, man, play me something of your own." And took an iPhone recording of that and sent it around to some people. And one of the people who responded very well and quickly to it was my now manager.
Nice.
His name's Ken Levitan. And he had me down in Nashville right away. And we were talking about working together and working on the craft and working on the writing and working on the performing and everything. And that was 4 years ago.
Describe the vibe of Nashville for people that have not been there.
Oh, it's really truly a city like no other. And it's only getting, I think it's getting better. And if that's even possible, there's so much life. There's so much going on in Nashville. Especially in music, which is what I'm doing, so it's easiest for me to speak on that. But everyone is so creative, and the culture there, everything's thriving. It's really something else. I by chance run into so many friends in Nashville. My roommate and now tour manager and sound guy, his name's Alex, and he's from the same small part of Canada that I'm from. We reconnected in Nashville. And
nice.
It's crazy how many, feels like a small town vibe, but at the same time, it's very much a big city.
When you did your first live show or the first few live shows there, was it a big buildup? Were there flyers everywhere, or was it more of a low-key thing for you?
It was definitely low-key. It was at this place called The Basement, which has so much history.
Yes.
I think famously Metallica played there, and you can't fit like 120 people in there, so if you can imagine that. And it's underneath Grimey's record shop, and that was a great experience, and it was very lucky to be able to play there right away.
Let's talk about going from Nashville to, hey, world, notice me, somebody in the business other than my manager, I'd like to put out some songs, and I'd like to have some backing just to help me out a little bit.
I was very lucky and fortunate to be able to go into different record labels and perform with my acoustic guitar. And very fortunate to even get in the door, of course, but go in and say, "Hey, this is what it is. This is what I. And I think there was no better way of doing it other than that. But yeah, surreal experience. Ultimately, landing with Interscope, which I was, very, very, and still very excited to be a part of.
And it goes from so fast for you to being a guy maybe looking up to some musicians to all of a sudden, 10 minutes later, you're in the same room.
Yeah.
And I know it's surreal, and I know it's exciting, but is there ever a part of you that's like, hold on a minute, what in the world's going on here, where you just need to like kind of shake yourself around to get you in the moment that you are the peer and not just some guy from Canada?
There's so many times where it's like crazy that I'm sitting in, the rooms I'm sitting in or sitting across from the people I'm sitting across from. And it's something that I don't want to get used to, because I want to constantly be able to look around and say, wow, this is
nice.
This is incredible.
It's a valley 3 years old. In her arms she held a cat, she'd rescue from the cold. It had one eye. Said, I'm bringing him inside. Sometimes I have to stop myself from giving her advice. She need not get up from the sits and park or make her cry. No, inside she won't be the one who's crying. It's a big old, big old world for a little, little girl. But this big old, big old world better get ready for you, little girl. She's a god to meet you, you're barely a month old. In her arms she held. She never let you go. What a sight. Now it's frozen in time. She was an actress. She was fearless, she was bold. Whatever you're old enough, the story will be told. What a life. Living on in your eyes. It's a big old, big old world.
We have a lot of people watching this show. Who would you like to work with out there? If you had a wish list, you rolled it out like Santa Claus good or bad list, who would be on your good list?
I'm so bad with these because, you give me options and I want
Jack White.
Everyone. Yeah, of course.
Dan Arbach.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, two bands, two musicians and writers and producers that definitely, once I started listening to music outside of what I was influenced by when I was young, were the White Stripes and the Black Keys very much. So, I mean, I'd be lying if I didn't say I knew all the tunes and knew all the records.
What's your plan for the rest of 2018 musically?
To get out as much music as I can, still, trying to find ways to broaden the audience as best I can. So I can't say that it's all coming out on this date. I don't know how exactly that's going to work, but my goal is to get as much of it out as possible and get in front of as many people as possible, definitely. So taking that music that is recorded and bringing it to live audiences, for sure.
Excellent, man. Thanks for being on the show.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Congratulations on everything you've done, man. I can see it in your eyes. You got it, man. You got it. Congratulations.
Thank you, brother.
He is Billy Raful. What a guy. Find him on the road. Explore his music. What a fun hour that was. And I'm Stryker. Thanks for watching, everybody. See you next time.